Hey, it's Professor Dave. Let's talk about acids and bases.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We've probably all heard the terms acid and base, but what do these words mean on the molecular level? Let's discuss the rigid definition according to a few different models. Most often, when we talk about acids and bases, we are referring to the bronsted-lowry definition. According to this model, an acid is something that donates a proton, and a base is something that accepts a proton. An H+ ion is a proton, because if a hydrogen atom loses an electron, all that is left is the proton that comprises the nucleus. Proton transfer is a big part of chemistry. An acid and base will react to form a conjugate acid-base pair. The thing that gives up a proton is the acid, the thing that accepts it is the base, and on the product side, the base has become the conjugate acid, and the acid has become the conjugate base, because the thing that gained the proton could potentially lose it again, acting as an acid, and the thing that lost the proton might gain it back, acting as a base. The Bronsted-Lowry definition only applies to protic species, or molecules with hydrogen atoms that can be lost as protons. But there are aprotic species that also display acidity and basicity. This is what the Lewis definition entails. Under the Lewis definition, a base is something that donates a pair of electrons, and an acid is something that accepts electrons. A Lewis base is indistinguishable from a Bronsted-Lowry base, but the acids differ in the sense that a Bronsted-Lowry acid must have at least one hydrogen atom. A Lewis acid just needs some partially positive atom. A species that can act as both a Bronsted-Lowry acid and base is said to be amphoteric. Water is amphoteric because it can behave as an acid, losing a proton to become hydroxide, or it can act as a base, gaining a proton to become a hydronium ion. In a sample of water, a tiny fraction of molecules transfer a proton from one to another, which we call an acid-base reaction. This is an equilibrium, and it's shown here. We can write an equilibrium expression by showing the concentrations of the products over the concentrations of the reactants. We will only include gases and aqueous substances, so here it will look like this. At room temperature, this equals 1 times 10 to the negative 14, or 1/100 trillionth. That's the fraction of water molecules that are ionized at any moment. As temperature increases, Kw increases. Hydronium concentration, which is essentially proton concentration, if above 1 times 10 to the negative 7, gives an acidic solution. If below, it's basic. If equal, it's neutral. When looking at conjugate acid-base pairs, we must understand that a strong acid is something that will very readily lose a proton. If something is a strong acid, it means its conjugate base is very stable. That's why it's so willing to lose a proton. A strong acid will have a weak conjugate base, since the conjugate base will be very stable, meaning it isn't dying to pick up a proton. A weak acid, something that isn't very willing to lose a proton, will have a strong conjugate base, something that will very easily gain a proton. So if the strength of an acid is proportional to the stability of the conjugate base, we have to be able to predict the stability of conjugate bases in order to tell how strong an acid will be. Whichever atom is losing a proton, the larger it is, the more stable the conjugate base will be. Comparing the acids made by combining a hydrogen with a halogen, we can see that Hi is the strongest. This is because when the proton leaves, we are left with an iodide ion. This is much larger than a fluoride ion, and therefore can diffuse the negative charge around a greater volume, thereby stabilizing itself. Fluoride is much smaller with a very localized charge, and is therefore less stable. So hydrofluoric acid is a much weaker acid than hydroiodic. Also, the more electronegative an atom, the better it is at accommodating a negative charge. So an oxygen atom can more readily lose a proton than a carbon atom, which is why something like water is far more acidic than, say, methane. Acids are also stronger when their conjugate bases are resonance stabilized. a carboxylic acid is about a trillion times stronger an acid than water, even though both of them leave an oxyanion after deprotonating. This is because the conjugate base of the carboxylic acid can share the burden of the negative charge between two oxygen atoms by resonance, while hydroxide can't. These resonance structures don't actually exist, but rather the composite resonance structure does, which shows delocalized pi electron density distributed about this portion of the molecule. More on this in organic chemistry. There can be monoprotic acids, which can only lose one proton, or polyprotic acids, which can lose several. Polyprotic acids become less acidic with each deprotonation. In an acid-base equilibrium, the side with the weaker acid-base pair will always be favored. This is because the stronger acid or base will have a greater tendency to react and generate the weaker species. We can tell acid strength by looking at an acid's pKa. The lower the pKa, the stronger the acid. Strong acids deprotonate completely, transferring every acidic proton to molecules of solvent or other things in solution. Weak acids only deprotonate partially, generating some of the conjugate acid, but won't react completely. The weaker they are, the less completely they will react. Once again, the hydronium concentration measures the degree to which an acid transfers protons to water molecules, and therefore the strength of the acid. But hydronium concentrations have inconvenient exponents, which can be cumbersome to list. So we have developed a more convenient way to describe acidity. The pH of a solution is the negative log of the hydronium concentration. Logarithms are the inverse operations of exponents, so the reason why a negative log is useful here is that it takes an annoying number like 10 to the negative 7, and it turns it into 7, which is much tidier. So a solution with a pH of 7 has a hydronium concentration that is considered neutral. We can also measure the basicity of a solution by calculating the pOH. This is because a strong base will generate hydroxide ions in aqueous solution by stealing protons from water molecules. Just like pH, pOH is the negative log of the hydroxide concentration. Another way to calculate pH and pOH is by using the formula for Kw. From this, we see that pH plus pOH must equal 14. Between these relationships, we can relate pH, pOH, hydronium concentration, and hydroxide concentration, and we should be able to get from one to any of the others using this chart. Let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials, and as always, feel free to email me, professordaveexplains@gmail.com.